Welcome, everybody. My name is Roosbelinda, Cardenas. I think I know everybody here. I also go back to I am very excited. There's a number of reasons why I feel really happy at this moment. One is, I can't remember the last time I was in a room with this many bodies in it and making community and sharing really good stuff. So I'm very thankful for that. Thank you for coming. I'm also very excited because this is our first cohort of this ECG faculty and staff of color fellowship. For those of you who are not familiar with this initiative, spread the word. But this fellowship program is meant to support the research, the work, the art, the wonderful things that our faculty and staff of color do on this campus. And I wanted to say just a couple of things about that. Some of you know, some of you are in the class, I see Aviva. Professor Jordan and I are teaching a course this semester that is called Striving Towards an Anti-Racist College. But what we're doing in the class right now is looking at archives of student mobilizations at Hampshire. And we've been looking at the 1988 Dakin protest, and today we looked at 1992 Coal Science. And there's a recurrent theme about the need to recruit, support, retain faculty of color, faculty and staff of color. So this is an ongoing demand by students and an ongoing commitment that Hampshire needs to continue to maintain. I also want to say that I think that this is important not just in terms of representations of the bodies of the people who are doing this work, but of the substance of the work that they're bringing. That this is the kind of work that is not about commodifying the cultural projects of racial others, but that it is deeply embedded in the communities and experiences that they're coming out of, and that this is exactly the kind of work that we want to support in Hampshire. So it's an honor. We're gonna start with Deb. Okay, so I'm gonna do a five and a two, and let me just introduce, for people who don't know, Professor Deb Goffe, who's also been on sabbatical, so maybe some of the students don't know you.
Sure.
Yep. This year. Mm-hmm. Associate Professor of Dance and Performance Curation is going to be presenting on their work, Liturgy, Order, Bridge.
Hi, everybody. So I had some idea that I was going to make a cohesive presentation. And then as I was sitting down to it, I was like, that's not where you are in your process. That's a ridiculous thing to do. You're making yourself anxious. So I'm going to set my timer. And that's going to be the frame. And I have some things that are written, other things that I'll just show you really quickly that this project, I'll tell you a little bit more about what it is, but what you're looking at is a process page. It's a password-protected process page for myself and my collaborators. It has language that I've used about the project for ourselves and for grants. It's got dates that we remember. It's got pictures that have accumulated from our process thus far, and lots of video from many, many iterations. So I'm just gonna be using this as a place to like bounce around. So I might show some video of stuff. I don't know what's gonna happen. But I thought that maybe a good way to begin, maybe I'll just like settle on some nice images or something. A good way to begin, I'll make it bigger. Look at those pretty people, they're so pretty. I'll tell you about my friends too. So I'm thinking of I'm calling this what I'm telling you right now. This is an unsuturing because that's where I am in the process with this project. And so in the summer of 2017, I initiated a creative process that I call Liturgy Order Bridge. I'll tell you why in a moment. The project has incubated slowly through a series of in-process showings and performances, where I've leveraged each discrete invitation to perform somewhere as an opportunity to gather my collaborators and push the project one step further. In February of 2020, we performed a 30-minute iteration of what had accumulated at that point. And there has been a long hiatus since that moment. We thought we were gonna like jump into it, and that was February of 2020. And so I've been trying to find my way back to the project since then. And this past summer, was a beginning of that. And we had a 10-day residency at Jacob's Pillow in January, which is where I thought, like, the momentum will return. And it kind of did, but what I now know, the reason that this word unsuturing is sort of my mantra with this, is that I learned that what I have is a Frankenstein. I have a work that has been knit together by the circumstances of each individual occasion, but that cohesion isn't necessarily true to the larger arc of the project. And so now is a time to start to do some unsuturing, to lay some things out in front of us, see what we have, what else do we really want to do, is any of this actually relevant, and to kind of begin again. Some funding that I've received that I'm excited about seemed to mean that, like, go, go, go was the point. It was like, 2020 is the moment, make it happen. Your sabbatical's almost over. And then I remembered that that had nothing to do with me or this project. And so we're taking our time. We're clear that nothing will truly manifest before next year. And so unsuturing is what I'm up to. So I thought I would tell you about what I believe to be 4 or 5 points of entry to this project. And a little bit about maybe what unsuturing has looked like in the last month. We'll see what happens with that. So one aspect of how this project came to be, a lot started in 2017. Many other things are about my whole life, right? But in 2017, I began a research process that I think is undergirding a lot of this project. So that's one thing. Another is, my personal faith practice throughout my adult life, so that's another. A memory that I have of a failed post-performance talk in 2017. And another is fashion shows. And maybe I'll talk a little bit about my previous project, Privy, that I think also factors into this. But here's a description that I've been using of the project lately. Liturgy Order Bridge is a performance installation that invokes the intimacies of care practices, the contrasting spectacle and absurdities of religious ritual, and the communal embodiment of Black church traditions. 3 simultaneous scores are woven together by our intersecting identities, senses of place, conditions of hospitality, and commitments to support of one another. We come together to reconcile the complexities of individual voice with the synchronicity of group body, in swells of mutuality. In the world we imagine together, flowers grow to human scale, as you can see in that picture. And 3 bodies find unity under the drape of a single liturgical vestment. We engage the reorienting and restorative power of collective movement, clapping, singing, and call and response. We define virtuosity in a chorus of step touches. These gestures are prayer and praise, correlating religious ritual with theatrical devices to make the membrane between performance and audience more porous, and inviting audiences out of an inactive viewership of difference to active and inclusive participation. Some of the questions I'm asking is, what might it mean to engage dance practice as faith practice? Performance as communal ceremony. Performance space as consecrated site. An audience as a fellowship of shared witness, place, and legacy. How might we nurture shared, though distinct, responsibilities for the dynamism and consequence of the encounter between performance and audience? And what is the potential of an organized body of practitioners devoted to facilitating the threshold between performance and the rest of life? My collaborators in this project, you've seen 3 of us there, I'm in it, but also Lauren Horn, who's an alum of Amherst College, actually, and she is currently a text and movement artist based in Connecticut, and director of a project called Sabira versus Movement. Erin Wilkerson, who's another former student of mine from very long ago, who's a dance artist, an installation artist, and director of a project called Tumut Astro. And Abna Kumsen Davis, who is a teacher and program director of a middle school ethics program, and also a musician who originated the role of Fumilayo in the Broadway musical Fela. and she's my best friend since age 11, and my first choreographic collaborator, and it's the first time in a long time that we're making something together. So she had not been in the project up to this point, but she is joining us since this past summer, and that's us. That's us in Provincetown this past summer, just starting to think, like, what does it mean for you to be in this practice? What does it mean for you to be moving again? And what does it mean for us to be singing together? Each of us grew up in and around Hartford, Connecticut. And we come together in this project with an enduring commitment to that place and to communities of color in that place. And to the idea of putting performance practice to work for the greater good of our harmonious and wildly divergent art-making practices. So that's a bit of an overview. So in 2018 and 2019, sort of this first point of entry being a concern for local, regional, and national arts ecologies and how they work or don't work, both for my colleagues, people that I was seeing around me, but also for my own practice. And so I set about this research practice to talk back to a commissioned study by the New England Foundation for the Arts that happened in 2016. And in this study that was called Moving Dance Forward, they found, though it's New England Foundation for the Arts, they do a lot of programming, and some of it is some funding, some of the more important national funding for dance touring around the country. And they found in that study, as they were assessing 20 years of this huge sort of pivotal part of their granting program, that only 2.9% of the grants that they had been distributing to artists to tour around the country were actually being allocated to dance artists from New England. And so that seemed like a concern to them, as it should. It was not a surprise to any of us living here and trying to make work in New England, but they took that study as impetus to begin a series of conversations both with dance artists across the region and also with what they called cultural organizers, sort of a bucket holding funders, presenters, and various arts institutions to start talking about why was that and what might be done about it. And so they held two convenings at Jacob's Pillow in 2017 around that, and I was present for both of those conversations. They were sort of like 3 or 4 day retreats. And I came out of both of those experiences really encouraged by the people that I was around, but feeling like we had not begun to have the conversation. And so in 2018 and 2019, I thought I wanted to spend a little bit more time thinking about the dynamics of how New England dance artists were operating, why there was this discrepancy. And one of the things that became relevant to me in that was a question of orientation. It became clear that the cultural organizers and the artists seemed to be orienting themselves to particular geographies that were not here. And that orientation has a lot to do with what we see and how we perceive. And I'd written during that time this little excerpt. For quite some time now, I've been craning my neck and contorting my body in order to see and understand the ways dance practice is sustained in my local environment from as many vantage points as possible. I imagine myself pausing atop one grassy mound after another for as long as is necessary to take sustained panoramic scans of the expanse around me. I imagine occasionally repositioning my frame to a crouched and twisted pose in which I repeat that process under, over, and around. Through this practice of slow, wide, and persistent seeing, I've grown increasingly aware of complex matrices of artists, organizations, and publics, as well as the social, political, and economic conditions that bind them. This attention to systems of interdependence constitutes an ecological framework that has formed a foundation for my current research. What has emerged has been an ongoing exercise in reorientation. And so I just found myself noticing a lot about how we were oriented and what that meant about how we were seeing each other, and what that meant about the kinds of support that we were affording each other. And who was authorized and who wasn't. And so one of the things I came to realize in talking to artists, I held a number of conversations with artists here in Western Mass. And did a case study on an artist, actually on Arian, the person I'm now collaborating with, who was based in Hartford at the time, now living in Philly, just to try to see if I could start to make sense of how people were operating. And what I noticed was what I came to call nested arts ecosystems, where it seemed that artists, I now understand it's not particular to New England. It's a strategy in a country with very little actual infrastructure for the arts, to knit together resources, their affiliations with organizations, their relationships across familial, friend, and professional contexts, municipal resources, right? That they sort of, that there's a way of identifying resource, connection, relationship, and knitting them together in ways that might seem disparate to whatever the dominant organizational structures are, and that they survive that way. They make things happen that way. One of the reasons we see art happening in places that are not perceived to be cultural centers is because of this ability to knit together. And yet, because they operate outside of conventional channels, that work is often invisible, right? I say all of this because part of what happened in, so 2017 is this moment, and that's the moment I started to think about this piece. I started thinking about what my own nested art ecosystem look like, right? So that it's operating within this larger ecosystem. It's pulling things in disparate directions toward itself, that there are many of them, it's multiple. And I must have one. And I wanted to assess, like, who are the people, what are the organizations, what are the kinds of connections that I'm making? And it was really obvious. I'd been performing in my own home, right? There was a way that I was like, oh, I don't recognize a curatorial frame that felt safe for the work I was making at the time, but I felt like I could make it in my own space, and so I did. That I was able to curate my own audiences, that a close friend from childhood was going to be like a partner on it, somebody else that I'd known from so-and-so, and if I needed a cousin to make a costume, I'd refer to them, right? That there was something sort of organic about the ways those relationships came together, but that it also, again, was, I struggled to make that visible outside of my own network. And so this is an effort for me to start to pull together some relationships and to start to amplify some of those connections differently. The intimacy that I created in my home, was it possible to scale that? Not for the sake of making it bigger for commodity sake, but so that I might be able to engage other folks besides my personal circle in that level of intimacy. So that's a point of entry. I'll just quickly say that in addition to that, I had spent the first 12 years of my life engaged in a pretty all-encompassing faith practice. And while that's no longer the practice that I am living in, it defined a lot about the way that I was making work. For a while, I sort of was like, I'm making postmodern liturgical dance, which I never tried to figure out what I meant by that. It was mostly a joke. But there's also part of me that's wondered what part of that still lives in my practice. Is there something about those experiences that drew me to that life that still informs how and why I gather people, what I want to see happen in a performance space, and the idea that performance space and relationship between performer and audience might be sacred. I'm also thinking about a performance that I saw, a play that I saw in Amherst in 2017, a lot happened then, during the summer, where friends of mine from Hartford were performing this play. Thank you. It was a play largely about Black experience. I know I'm being reductive, I just don't want to get into the details too much. And when the play was over, there was a talkback, I hate that term. It was a talkback, and the audience was largely white. There were two people of color, I was one of the two in the audience, and the conversation was weird. It was a weird conversation, and it was clear that no one had thought about how that conversation needed to be held. There was a very well-meaning white lady sitting about there in the audience, weeping through the whole talk back, and I was like, what is happening? Is anybody gonna help her and help her know why this maybe is not the right place for that? Like, it was just, it was weird. And so my friend and I are sitting, we'd had so many conversations about how performances are framed. We'd spent a lot of time practicing conversations after performances with audiences, and we started to just like joke, like, what if there was a clergy, like an order of clergy devoted only to the conversations after performances and how you help the people after, is somebody gonna go get her and help her? Like, so that was, we were sort of joking about that. So that's another piece of information here. And the last is fashion shows. Black church people love fashion shows. I don't know what that is about, but in conversations with Lauren one time we were talking about that, I had not yet caught on to, I know there's a lot of stuff. Okay, did I find it? There's the Pyre Moss fashion show of summer 20, where Kirby, what's Kirby's last name, the designer? It's not coming to me right now, my apologies, but where the fashion show was this like church service. So there's, I'm just gonna skip around, but there's like singing, there's a choir. Hello, ad. Singing these covers of popular song, popular music. I mean, Anita Baker, what else do you need to know? There's this giant square stage that I realized lately that the vision I have for the stage is actually this stage, so I guess it's made its way into my brain. Anyway, I love it. Look it up. It's really good. So those are points of entry. So what's happened in the time since we've been playing with this, oh, and fashion show also, because Federico Fellini, there's this ecclesiastical fashion show that I'm obsessed with. A former mentor of mine showed this to me in like 1996 or something, and I've been obsessed ever since. And it's a similar, but much more absurd idea of this fashion show for a bishop or pope or somebody in Rome. And it gets increasingly absurd. You can't quite hear the music here, but it's really, it gets more absurd as well. And, you know, there's somebody narrating the fashions and the context of the fashions. There's like a little wink and a nod to like colonization here about what you're wearing in the Caribbean. And it gets, it just becomes absurdist art at some, like performance art at some point. At some point, thank you. What people, like the people matter less and these art objects of the garments become, and it lifts people to their feet. They're overcome by the end, despite the fact that the person wearing the garment looks like a skeleton. So these are some of the things that I'm tossing around, and what's come about, just trying to find a little. This was January of 2020. Is and I'm skipping around. So those are our flowers. Yeah, that one's mine. And the three-headed monster, as we call it, where we're wearing this robe together. And I think I'll just say, like, you know, we're playing with ways of engaging the audience. We ask audience to clap with us and to rise with us, whatever that means to them, to sing with us. I'm imagining a space where what I've called a threshold chorus is encircling the audience the whole time. And I got to work with a group of high school students where we played with that idea and discovered that a step touch is a powerful and virtuosic thing. And so this is a little bit of these high school students in this movement chorus. So now it's time to pull it all apart and start again, and to figure out what this liturgy actually looks like. So I'll let you know how it goes.
Thank you, Deb.
Thank you.
So now I'm going to introduce Professor Lili Kim, who's Associate Professor of History and Global Migration, and is going to be sharing with us her project, In Transit, Gender, Race, and Korean Migration to Argentina, and Remigration to the United States.
Thanks, Rose, for the introduction, and Javier for organizing this evening. I'm so excited to be here and share the stage with my colleagues, Deb and Susana, whom I admire very much. And I'm also super excited and honored to share this space with you all to celebrate the work of women faculty of color at Hampshire. I don't think we did this enough. So thank you all for being here. And it means a lot to me that you're here to learn something about my and my colleagues' work. So thank you. So this is my second book project, the seeds of which were planted many, many years ago when I first moved to Boston. And some of you know that a lot of Korean immigrants own dry cleaners, and my dry cleaner was Korean, which was not surprising. But what was surprising was that she had lived in Argentina for 20 years before she moved to Boston. And this was such a news to me. I didn't realize that there were Koreans living in Argentina. And as a historian of Korean diaspora, I knew that one day I'm going to be writing about this. So that was many years ago, and I get to do this now, which I'm really excited to do. So my project examines the little-known history of Korean migration to Argentina that began in 1965 as a result of the agricultural treaty signed between South Korea and Argentina, as well as the subsequent remigration of Koreans to the United States in 1990. This presentation will focus on reconstructing the history of early settlements of Koreans as agricultural workers in the rural town of La Marque, Argentina, and how Korean migrants came to dominate the garment and textile industry as laborers and as business owners in Buenos Aires. Utilizing both Korean and Spanish sources, I explored the centrality of Korean women's gendered labor and the formation of Korean-Argentine communities in the face of racial discrimination and economic scapegoating during multiple Argentinian economic crises in the context of globalization of labor and migration. I also explored generational relationships between mothers and daughters working closely together in their garment industry work as families. Korean Argentine migrants have settled in major U.S. cities like New York, Boston, and Los Angeles, and once again have taken up garment businesses. I'm interested in investigating the relationships between these Korean Argentine Americans with many Latin American immigrants that they employ in their businesses and interact with in these cities as well, which is sort of the third part of my larger book project. So as you can imagine, this is a three-continental, multilingual project. So logistically, it's been kind of difficult to kind of try to make progress on this. But nevertheless, here we go. OK, so how is our understanding of US immigration history and the process of acculturation and identity construction of immigrants altered when the United States is not the only place that a particular group of immigrants has settled in since leaving their home country? My examination of the history of Korean triangular migration from Korea to Argentina to the United States necessarily forces us to rethink traditional framework of diasporas that pose binary categories of old and new cultures and homeland and newly adopted country. Equally central to the aim of this project is to historicize the conditions of globalization that affect the flow and trajectory of people who arrive in the United States. To be sure, there are multiple definitions of globalization and many layers of influences that globalization has on migration. Here, I'm interested not only in the globalizing economy that most often facilitates the flow of migrants, but also in the set of conditions that intensify and accelerate social interactions, exchanges, and networks to overcome traditional political, cultural, economic, and geographical boundaries. But first, a word about the archival building that I had to do in order to write this work. To interpret the past, we historians look at what we call primary sources, written and oral documents and material cultures that are left behind by historical actors. Korean migrants in Argentina, like many marginalized peoples, do not have archives built after them. But these migrants knew that they were nevertheless making history, and they were actively documenting and preserving their experiences. So for example, two of the sources that I uncovered during my Fulbright years in Seoul, South Korea, are written in Korean by Korean Argentine migrants themselves who understood and were committed to creating their own archives to document the history of Korean Argentine community formation. So the image on the left, the yellow cover, is a long memoir written by a Korean migrant to Argentina, documenting their everyday life before, during, and after their migration to Buenos Aires. It's kind of tedious reading, if I'm being honest, but in these mundane accounts of what took to move across the world, provide us with a window into agencies of these migrants. The second source is a collection of essays by a group of community members calling themselves belonging to the Argentina Korean Immigration Cultural Research Center. Men and women, old and young, all contributed to this volume to document their existence and experiences as Korean immigrants in Buenos Aires. So this kind of active history making and history writing by the community members themselves has allowed me to engage in this project, and I also conducted oral history interviews with migrants themselves. So you're gonna get to hear about my dry cleaner that I first initially met. I went back and interviewed her, so time allowing, I'm gonna share some of her stories with you as well. The history of modern Korean migration to Argentina and elsewhere in the world has to be contextualized in the post-Korean War reconstruction efforts. After the devastating physical and economic destruction produced by the war and the subsequent poverty that followed, the newly formed South Korean government actively encouraged the exodus of its citizens as a way of mitigating the dire economic conditions. The South Korean government also sought to establish economic treaty agreements with other countries to export Koreans as laborers. Argentina was one of the few countries that responded positively. The first major wave of Korean migrants arrived in 1965 as farm laborers settled in La Marque, Argentina. South Korea had signed a diplomatic agreement with Argentina in 1962, agreeing to send Korean laborers to work in the agricultural sector. The second wave of Korean immigrants, some 200 families, mostly middle or lower middle class, arrived between 1970 and 1977, when immigration to the United States was preferred but difficult to achieve because of the high number of people wanting to immigrate to the United States after the immigration reform in 1965 that allowed family sponsorships by Asian immigrants. In 1983, Argentina relaxed its immigration policy and encouraged middle-class people who could aid its efforts to increase currency circulation. Anyone who had $30,000 was allowed to legally immigrate. This resulted in about 20,000 Korean migrating to Argentina between 1984 and 1986. Now, we have to remember that this period, the mid-80s, was still the height of Korean immigration to the United States. While there was a long waiting period to immigrate to the United States, people who had the money could immigrate to Argentina almost immediately. Another attractive factor was that residents of Argentina at the time did not have to get a visa to go to the United States. And this surely was attractive for Koreans who always thought of Argentina as a stepping stone. Hence the title of my book and my talk, In Transit. According to Argentine anthropologist Carolina Mera, there were approximately 35,000 Koreans in Argentina in 1998. Since then, many have remigrated to the United States and Canada, and some have even gone back to South Korea, and the latest figure that I have of Koreans in Argentina is around 23,000. So there are about, you know, 15 or so thousand people who have remigrated since. So Koreans initially arrived as agricultural workers. They were not farmers in Korea. Most of them were recruited through a church in the Yongsan district of Seoul. There was a deliberate effort to recruit Koreans of all backgrounds. They wanted a doctor in case anyone got sick, so there was a doctor in the group, as well as an orphanage head and professor of livestock farming. They were unprepared for the harsh life of cultivating land that was not fertile when they arrived. The 15 families that came over together under the agricultural treaty stuck together, but the living and working conditions were deplorable. They were given free land to cultivate, but the land was not fertile, the weather was extreme, either too dry or too wet, and together they provided an impossible condition to grow anything. But they didn't come all the way across the world to fail or to passively face their fate. They started to pull their money together to send messages to South Korea for help. They began petitioning the South Korean government to provide them with necessary equipment to farm. They had brought with them basic tools like shovels, hoes, and pickaxes, but they quickly realized they needed land clearing machines such as bulldozers and tractors. South Korean government eventually agreed to send some of those machines, but they were old models and needed fuel to operate, which did not come by easily. In less than 2 years, the initial group of Korean farm laborers began abandoning farming and fled to the city of Buenos Aires. There they found themselves in a shanty town and did whatever work they could find to survive. Writing about these very early, brutally difficult years, the Korean migrants in their writing referred to themselves as, quote, virtually neglected immigrants, unquote, because no one cared, not Argentine government, nor the South Korean government, whether they survived or not. After moving to Buenos Aires, Koreans began sewing as a way to survive. Because this was illegal work without work permit, they had to be careful not to get caught, but they were able to do good work for very cheaply. So soon, Jewish immigrants who owned garment factories at the time sought them out. And little by little, Koreans began learning how to produce their own garments. When Jewish immigrants retired or moved into suburbs, Koreans were able to move in and start operating garment factories as well. Stunningly, more than 90% of Koreans in Argentina currently own businesses or work in all aspects, design, production, distribution, sales of the garment industry. Korean migrants, especially those part of later waves, brought considerable skills in sewing and tailoring as they were engaged in such sectors before migrating to Latin America and had an easier time adjusting economically. So Argentine immigration history provides an interesting context for Korean immigration and remigration to the United States. Any discussion of Argentine immigration history has to acknowledge the indigenous people's presence before conquest and colonization. As a settler government, Argentina's 1853 constitution declared, quote, to govern is to populate, unquote, and welcomed the large waves of European immigrants from Spain and Italy in particular, and Russians, French, and Germans in smaller numbers. Yet this welcoming mantra should not be mistaken as a sign of Argentina's egalitarian tradition, for official Argentine immigration policies favored attracting white European immigrants, and the Argentine government blatantly discriminated against other neighboring South American immigrants from Bolivia and Paraguay, mm-hmm. and began deporting undocumented immigrants. Furthermore, many indigenous people were displaced to accommodate settlements of new European immigrants. In this context of political and social dominance of white European descendants, Korean immigrants were never encouraged to, or were able to, or perhaps never even desired to, incorporate themselves fully into Argentine society. Koreans in the early years of migration primarily resided in well-defined and segregated barrios, such as Barrio 109, which was named after the bus number that went through the neighborhood, as well as Barrio 11 and the Flores District. While the clothing sales stores were found primarily in the 11 neighborhood, today, the large area known as Avenida Avenidera serves as the hub of Korean-owned wholesale garment stores in Buenos Aires. In these sprawling spaces, Korean shop owners coexisted and compete with Bolivian street vendors who sell clothing and other items at a much cheaper price due to not having to pay rent. So this is the avenue where Koreans own wholesale garment stores, and this is about 50 blocks of street in Buenos Aires. And any given weekend, it's jam-packed with customers wanting to shop there. This is before COVID, perhaps not after COVID. And then this is, you know, Bolivian street vendors who also sell clothing items as well. And then inside the store is, it's a pretty compact space, but customers can kind of look at the samples of what they want, and then they can bulk order as well. So as a social historian, I'm interested in uncovering the experiences of ordinary people making history every day. The history of Korean migration to Argentina is not just about the circulation of capital, skills, or products, but at the heart of it is a series of difficult choices made by ordinary people and exercising their agency under particular sets of historical, social, political, and economic circumstances. Oral history has been an important tool for recovering the historical experiences of those lives that are left undocumented in the archives and by other traditional historical sources. While people's memory is not always reliable, oral history interviews still provide a useful insight into how people actively remember the past. As many oral historians have documented and articulated, present meanings of what has happened found in oral history interviews, that is to say, how people remember and give meaning to the past, are part of the history and the historical narratives we construct about the past that takes into consideration living people's memories. The oral history interviews that I conducted with the first and second generation Korean Argentine women reveal a network of close communities, but most strikingly, the resilient power of families held together most often by women, wives, mothers, daughters, and sisters. The close and intimate spaces of home that also functions as workspace allow for the structure that blurs the lines between family, employee, and boss. In this blended space of work and life, women are actively involved in the running of the family garment businesses, but also maintaining their role as wives, mothers, daughters, and sisters in a reconfigured way that consists of both conflicts and closeness that any intensified relationships bring. So I want to share with you now some examples of the oral histories I conducted to illustrate how a close working relationship among Korean-Argentine family members in the garment industry affect gender and generational dynamics. Going into the garment business is almost natural for Koreans in Argentina. Mrs. Oh told me, quote, "It is so easy to get into the business because the path has been already laid before. It truly is a family business. Everyone, even young kids, help contribute." Mrs. Oh immigrated to Argentina as a young child with her family, and her family's garment manufacturing and wholesale business in Buenos Aires has had a huge impact on her relationship with her family growing up. The family and school life had to revolve around the business in many ways. The way she conducted herself growing up had a lot to do with her family's business and consideration of how busy her parents were. She says, quote, "I had to study hard in school and be on my best behavior. If I got into trouble, my parents would be called in. My parents didn't speak Spanish, and they would have to take time off from working at the store." Lovingly describing her experience of helping out after school and on weekends, Mrs. Oh continued, quote, "It was a protection for me. I was young when we moved to Argentina, and by working at home, making these garments, I stayed out of trouble. It protected me. And my mother used this time while we sewed. In many cases, I would clip the thread on clothes to tell me about Korean history and cultural tradition. I learned a lot, and this made me feel so close to my mother. I never lost the Korean language, even though I came to Argentina at a young age, because the family stays together like this." Her childhood experience helping her mom and working hard instilled a strong work ethic in her. And even though she describes her experience fondly, she never wanted to take the same career path. In fact, she studied in the university and worked in the bank for 10 years, but she got bored and she could make so much more money working in the store. So she came back to the business and started opening her own stores. Mrs. K moved to Argentina on 5th of March, 1993. So she was part of a much later wave of Korean migration to Argentina. Her husband's sister was married to a man who was in the business of producing sweaters, and they had been living in Buenos Aires. Hearing from them how good the garment business was there, they decided to immigrate to Buenos Aires as well. She and her husband, along with their two children, who were only 3 and 6 at the time, applied for a tourist visa while planning to permanently move to Buenos Aires. They had to wait only 1.5 months for their tourist visa, so everything had to be finalized as quickly as possible. She had owned a small convenience store in Seoul, so she sold her store as well as her house. Upon arriving in Buenos Aires, they quickly set up a garment factory with the help of her husband's sister's family, which is very typical way of Korean immigrants who can, it seems like they can arrive and then overnight they can start up their businesses. As she told me, quote, "The business in the early days was really good. It was no big deal to make over $1,500 a day. You could sometimes make up to $10,000 on a really good day. The joke back in the days was that you would have to stay up all night just to count the money that you made that day. That was a job in and of itself, just counting all the money." But their good fortune began to change after a few years of their arriving there. The economic recession began to affect their business. Contrary to the popular perception that Korean business owners escaped unscathed from the economic crisis in Argentina, Mrs. K insists that Koreans were hit harder than Argentinians. During the economic crisis, Koreans suffered a lot more than Argentinians. We weren't prepared for the hard times. Making money had been so easy. We never thought to save up for hard times. Argentines, they had saved and they prepared, but not Koreans. That's why we suffered more. We also benefited more during the good times. We benefited more and we suffered more. And then I'm gonna end with this oral history interview. She talked about how Koreans were singled out by bureaucrats, particularly by the cops. So she told me, quote, "Koreans were picked on by the police a lot. Koreans would get stopped by the police all the time in Buenos Aires. So if you're walking down the street, the police will stop you and harass you for no reason. So what you do is pay them and they leave you alone. They ask for your resident card, and when you hand them your resident card, you also hand 50 pesos, about $50 at the time. That was how it worked. If you don't pay them, they will arrest you and detain you for 2 hours for whatever charges they make up. They knew they couldn't get away with this with Koreans because of the language barrier. They can make up a number of reasons, and even if they tell you, you can't understand them because of the language barrier. Koreans are hardworking people. They have work to do. Who has 2 hours to be detained? So they'd rather bribe the cops and be free. The cops stopping you know that this is what's going to happen, so it's like getting free pocket money each time they stop a Korean. I got tired of all of this. Also, making money became not so easy. When we got to Buenos Aires, the first 2 years were really good. We never knew how easy it was to make money. And then things started to slow down. So I asked her more about sort of her working relationships with her husband. They work, you know, 6 days a week. And then even though she contributes equally, if not more, to family economy, the domestic realm still belongs to her. So she comes home, she does all the cooking and cleaning, et cetera. So since I'm out of time, to conclude, scholars of globalization and migration have emphasized the creation of transnational migrant families who, as part and parcel of the forces of economic global migration, are forced to be physically apart and have to live across different nation-state borders. In many ways, Korean-Argentine families working in the garment industry together are the opposite example, where the forces of globalization have provided a structure of family units as workforce and are in close proximity of each other working and living together. In this historically specific political economy of the garment industry in Argentina, gender relationships across different generations provide a unique window into understanding evolving family and generational dynamics that do not fit into the prevailing notions of families living apart in different countries or even continents as consequences of global labor migrations. The unique challenges and rewards of intensified family relationships that Korean women experience working in the highly labor-intensive garment industry in Argentina demonstrate the possibilities and limits of gendered empowerment of Korean women. Thank you.
All right, so I'm gonna assume everybody knows what Twilight is, and I'm not gonna go through a synopsis. You can just look at the posters. My presentation unmasks the inextricable connections between gender construction, national formation, and racial monsterization in the US settler colonial state through close analysis of Twilight Saga, which is based on the who knows why popular book series. I consider how Twilight uses conflict and territorial disputes between white vampires and indigenous monsters to express and manage white male anxieties about invasion, contamination, segregation, miscegenation, conquest, and demographic change. In Recovering the Sacred, the Power of Naming and Claiming, Winona LaDuc suggests that the descendants of settlers are, in a sense, haunted by nostalgia. For this lost cultures and fabled pride, their forebears worked so hard to annihilate. The sociopathology of the United States rests on its colonialist history, and in particular, on the awesome weight of genocide. The Twilight Saga alleviates this genocidal guilt in a variety of ways. It upholds dominant ideas about race that associate whiteness with civility, beauty, and intellect on the one hand, and indigenous people with animality and primitivism on the other. It recreates the clash of colonizer and colonized with white vampires and native werewolves, but has the battle end in a truce instead of brutal subjugation and total assimilation. It masks the American settler status of the Cullen family by juxtaposing it to the evil European Volturi. It erases slavery and romanticizes the lost cause via Jasper Whitlock. Before joining the undead Cullen clan, Jasper was a noble Confederate soldier. He was turned into a cruel and callous bloodsucker by a lustful and predatory indigenous Mexican woman seeking to form a vampire army on the US-Mexican border. My examination of Twilight reveals the fragility of white settler memory, its obsessive reiteration of false national narratives, its symbolic recolonization of the Americas as the home of European explorers and migrants. Eve Tuck and Kay Wei Yang have dubbed such maneuvers settler moves to innocence. Settler moves to innocence are strategies, positionings, or evasions that attempt to relieve the settler feelings of guilt or responsibility without giving up land or power or privilege. Mm-hmm. Let us consider three settler moves to innocence in the series. I'll begin with a scene from New Moon, the second film in the saga. This scene exemplifies the noble savage trope that is cultivated across the series. In this scene, Bella discovers that her friend and romantic admirer, Jacob Blake, is a werewolf.
What did you do? Hey, what did you do? Hey, what did you do to him?
Easy.
He didn't want this.
What did we do? What did he do? What did he tell you?
Both of you, calm down.
Nothing. He tells me nothing because he's scared of you. Too late now.
Bella, get back. Oh, calm down now.
Bella! Run! Jake, run!
That's all you need to see about that. In Gothic Images of Race, H.L. Malchow discusses how both Gothic texts and racist discourse manipulate deeply buried anxieties. Both dwell on the chaos beyond natural and rational boundaries and massage a deep, often unconscious, and sexual fear of contamination.
Both present the threatened destruction of the simple and pure by the poisonously exotic, by anarchic forces of passion and appetite, carnal lust and bloodlust. The previous clip speaks directly and viscerally to such anxieties. It also reminds us that white women have a doubled relation to difference. On the one hand, Bella occupies the role of sexualized object, much like the indigenous werewolves. On the other, she is also the colonizer who objectifies the native bodies and consumes them. Recall how this encounter begins with her observing their half-naked brown bodies on the horizon. By encouraging viewers to take pleasure in the spectacle of a savage werewolves fighting over the fate of a white damsel in distress, Twilight simultaneously exoticizes natives and constructs them as uncivilized and in need of subjugation by the white settler. The film reinforces a white settler desire by allowing Jacob's half-naked body to be fully objectified, thus following a long tradition in American culture that began with Columbus's study of the bodies on the half-clothed Indians of Hispaniola. As Curtis Merez reminds us, these forms of ritual imperial spectatorship indirectly help to reproduce conditions of domination by constituting Indian cultures as property and by encouraging a proprietary relationship to images of Indians. In the Twilight Saga, the Native Americans are not well-rounded, complicated protagonists. Instead, their presence is to provide a sense of lurking danger in the storyline. Jacob Black and his friends who make up the Wolf Pack are fictional Quileute tribal members. In addition to being shirtless exotic sex symbols, the men serve as an underlying threat. These characters are portrayed as largely controlled by their bestial nature. Whereas new vampires are controlled by their instincts for a year or so, the wolf men continue to have outbreaks of uncontrollable emotion as they mature. These volatile emotions unconsciously cause them to phase from human to animal form, suggesting that their instincts, rather than their rational thoughts and conscious emotions, control them. Jacob in particular serves as a threat to the romance between Bella and Edward, the two non-native settler protagonists. Though Jacob's character has a major role in the storyline, his character is severely underdeveloped when compared to others. Jacob testifies to the enduring appeal of the noble savage trope for Euro-American settlers like Bella. Jacob's ability to turn into a wolf also contributes to the romantic savage stereotype by reinforcing the ideology that Indians live in harmony with nature and have a natural existence. In fact, Jacob and his Indian brethren are so close to nature that they can transform into it. As werewolves, they become part of nature itself, conforming to the laws of the wolf behavior and pack mentality. But perhaps the most dangerous part of Meyer's depiction of native peoples is that she renders them mythical creatures. By imagining her cosmic epic battle between good and evil, between civilized white vampires and savage Indian werewolves, Meyer creates a binary that implies that native peoples are as equally fantastic, as equally fictional as vampires. This is a bold and disturbing settler move to innocence. Now move to another pivotal settler scene in the saga, when the Quileute met the Cold Ones, AKA the colonizing European vampires.
The Quileutes have been a small tribe from the beginning, that we have always had magic in our blood. We were great spirit warriors, shapeshifters, that transformed to the powerful wolf. This enabled us to scare off our enemies and protect our tribe. One day, our warriors came across a creature. It looked like a man, but it was hard like stone and cold as ice. Sharp teeth finally tore it apart, but only fire would completely destroy it. They lived in fear that the cold man was not alone. And they were right. She took her vengeance out on the village. Our elder chief, Taha Aki, was the only spirit warrior left to save the tribe after his son was killed. Taha Aki's third wife could see that he would lose. The third wife was no magical being, no special powers but one. Courage.
Scholarship on American Gothic has long argued that the figure of the Indian is central to the American imagination, symbolizing unresolved settler horror, guilt, and trauma from Poe to Meyer. More recently, Renee Berglund has suggested that the long history of colonial violence against natives is the fundamental raw material out of which American Gothic has been manufactured. According to Teresa Gadu, the Gothic tells of the historical horrors that make national identity possible, yet must be repeated in order to sustain it. The implications of these literary insights are rendered starkly in the previous scene. The semi-naked Quileute sit peacefully by the seashore, occupied in domestic tasks and surrounded by their children, when a single hyper-white man dressed in European clothing arrives on the beach, the implication being he has just arrived by sea. Vampires in the Twilight series do not so much represent the anxiety of reverse colonization, but rather a brutal reimagination of colonization itself. While the European cold ones are represented as barbaric and cruel in this scene from Eclipse, the invasion and destruction of the indigenous community is ultimately not caused by settler colonial greed and white supremacist arrogance, but rather it is depicted as an expression of the uncontrollable and inconsolable grief of the vampire's bereft lover. There are also other troubling settler moves to innocence in Twilight's first contact scenario. First, although we see the unmoving and likely dead bodies of Quileute children lying at the feet of the male European vampire, it is the wolves that attack first and are thus instigators of violence. Second, the fact that the tribal warriors are shapeshifters implicitly renders them as monsters, as beings that kill, wild beings to be feared, beings that may need to be tamed, controlled, or even put down. In Raising the Indigenous Dead, Eric Gary Anderson suggests that the problem with Gothic texts, like the Twilight Saga, are that they remain complicit with settler colonial operations. In Eclipse, the Quileute are literally howling savages who live in the wilderness and violently attack white people. Settler Gothic is not just another story form. It is a way of seeing the world that serves the social interests of white settlers. Whatever we might wish to say about its connections to other forms and archetypes and whatever its transmutations and ironic recastings, settler Gothic continues to depend in a remarkably straightforward way on the continued abjection of the native. While I've thus far focused on how the Twilight Saga uses indigenous werewolves to absolve white settler guilt, I would like to conclude by considering how the saga symbolically recuperates the Confederacy through its backstory of Jasper Whitlock. Okay, so this is wrong way. No, God. Okay, no. What happened? Yes, yeah, okay. All the clips of her look the same, so it's hard to tell. Yeah. I'm like, wait, this is the right.
This happened during the Civil War?
I was the youngest major in the Texas Cavalry. All without having seen any real battle.
Until
I met a certain immortal. Maria. I was riding back to Galveston after evacuating a column of women and children when I saw them. I immediately offered them my aid.
Lovely. And an officer. You'd better do it, Maria.
I can never stop once I've started.
What's your name, soldier?
Major Jasper Whitlock, ma'am.
I hope you survive. You may be of great use to me. Maria was creating an army?
They were very common in the South. Constant brutal battles for territory. Maria won them all. She was smart, careful, and she had me. I was her second in command. My My ability to control emotions served her well. I trained her newborns. In this occupation, since she never let them live beyond the first year, it was my job to dispose of them. Feel everything they felt.
Okay, we don't need to see Bella look very tragic. In African-American Gothic, Maisha Wester argues that the othered body, the not free, the not me of American culture, is made to enact all of the deviance and failures the white rational body denies, and so becomes monstrous and unfathomable, necessitating the whips dealt it daily. In Eclipse, Maria, the sexy Mexican monster amassing an army of baby vampires on the U.S. southern border, is that othered body. She is the uncanny monster enslaving whites and viciously murdering them when they have lost their utility for her. Mm-hmm. Jasper, the Confederate soldier fighting to preserve actual chattel slavery, is just an old-fashioned Southern gentleman caught in her duplicitous schemes. The scene is a truly astonishing example of a settler move to innocence, given the South's violent and traumatic history of lynching of blacks and Latinxes that dared to contest white supremacy and fight for their freedom. The erasure of Jasper's complicity with white supremacist settler colonialism, his projection of those historical horrors onto black and brown bodies, reminds us that Twilight Saga is not just an embarrassing pop culture aberration, but it is rather part of a continuum of American colonialist and imperialist violence. Violence that former President Trump enacted when he labeled all Mexicans rapists, banned all Muslims as terrorists, or referred to white neo-Nazis that march in Charlottesville as very fine people, or professed his love for those special racist rioters that stormed the Capitol on January 6th, to name but a few of literally hundreds of examples. In Dark Legacy, Gothic Ruptures in Southern Literature, Christopher Walsh asserts that the South has always been engaged in its own historical process of mythological construction. The old antebellum South was nothing but myth, and its narrative of supposedly halcyon past concealed all manner of social, familial, and of course, racial denials and suppression. As Alan Lloyd Smith has rightfully acknowledged, the Gothic is about the return of the past, of the repressed and denied, the buried secret that subverts and corrodes the present, that whatever the culture does not want to know or admit, will not or dare not tell itself. I'd like to conclude by returning to Godot in Gothic America. Oh, wait. That's where I wanted to be. In Gothic America, she observes, the nation's narratives, its foundational fictions and self-mythologizations are created through a process of displacement. Their coherence depends on exclusion. By resurrecting what these narratives repress, the Gothic disrupts the dream world of national myth with the nightmares of history. Moreover, in its narrative incoherence, the Gothic discloses the instability of America's self-representations. Its highly wrought form exposes the artificial foundations of national identity. However, while the Gothic reveals what haunts the nation's narratives, it can also coalesce those narratives. Like the abject, the Gothic serves as the ghost that both helps run the machine of national identity and disrupts it. The Gothic can strengthen as well as critique and idealize national identity. Twilight's settler moves to innocence attempt to absolve colonial guilt through monstrous displacement, but in fact what the saga does, accidentally, is release the indigenous specters that haunt this settler colonial state, thus temporarily disrupting the machinery of white supremacy and revealing its deadly foundational fictions.
Wow. I did want to acknowledge very briefly,
let me get over here for a second, that this cohort of fellowships actually had two other members that were fellows this past year. One of them is Jola Branner, who is an interdisciplinary theater artist and educator and used to belong to the faculty of Hampshire. And his project was
entitled The Benjamin Banneker Project, which was actually a genealogical exploration of an ancestor that he's turning into a script. And Junko Oba, who is associate professor of music, and her project, which is titled Reworking Brasilidade Narratives, Space, Time, and the Performance of Music and Identity in the Japanese Expatriate Community. They were not able to join us today, but I wanted to acknowledge their projects. So why don't we, let me raise your hand if you want to contribute, comment, ask questions, and I'll take a sec.
I have questions for each of you. Just thank you so much for presentations, and it's so great to hear about my colleagues' research and be in a room with them. When you were talking about this study about dance in New England, it being oriented towards geographies that are not here, and then talking about your own commitment to Hartford, and then also talking about how to make work that you're doing in intimate spaces more visible. I was kind of wondering, like, where are those orientations that you're kind of, what is that context, and where are you trying to fight against, I guess, to put it in stupid terms. So I'll just go through all the questions and then I'll ask you about it. I was so excited to hear more about your research, Lily. And I'm just wondering about, having known about you doing the archival research that's going between different continents, different languages, going into archives, but also into doing your own oral histories. And also thinking, as we're all trying to teach students how to work with those primary materials and then bringing them together. You talked about having your subjects having a series of difficult choices made by ordinary people as the history you're looking at. Where do you find the ability to bring those together into the narratives that inform the arguments of your work on this particular project? And then for Susana, as you were bringing it kind of to the present and thinking about Twilight, it's so funny, I just watched Kristen Stewart as Princess Di last night in the new movie Spencer, so I was like, oh God. Has in addition to your own work, have you seen kind of pop culture attitudes towards Twilight change at all in more recent years? And is there any conversation that goes back and looks at that work? Is there things coming out on other things like Joss Whedon, I know this is a thing, but has there been any different kinds of like re-approach to this work recently? That's it?
Yeah. I'll just say mine's fairly quick. I would say the re-release of all the Twilight movies on Netflix has revealed how critical it is to do this analysis of it, because it's being in the same way uncritically and romantically embraced. So I'm not seeing that.
Yeah, thanks for that question, Michelle. I think what's exciting about what historians do is that not two people will have the same reaction to what they're reading in terms of interpreting the primary sources. So, as I was reading these first-person narratives of Korean immigrants to Argentina, I couldn't help but think about like my own experience of spending 2 years in Seoul, South Korea, where I know the language and I look like I'm Korean American, but there is such difficulty just day-to-day life, just negotiating different rules, different unfamiliar, social norms and all of that, and whereas they took like months on, freight ship to get to Argentina, and just that kind of survival, I don't want to even say skills, but will to live. And then, one person talks about this is not a brilliant success story. It's not, your typical model minority myth of, Koreans making it in a foreign country. There's such hardship. And I just come away with such humility just reading through, that's sort of me reacting to it emotionally. And I want my students to engage with primary sources on that level. Like, have a historical imagination. How does this hit you? And, we can have conversations about that. And for sure, that's going to affect my interpretation of, the arguments I make. So, yeah, so I love those moments of when students have different reactions to different materials. So, yeah, thanks.
I'm taking a moment just because I was saying to Lily that it was that talk was making me think a lot about my own immigrant parents and the multiple places people went and the members of my family that went to England and then arrived here, or the people that went and stayed in these different places. And I'm just hearing my mother, who was supposed to have gone to England and wasn't able to go, and ended up here much later. And she has this idea that she would not have made it had she gone, when she knows what my aunt went through going there. And so this, it's just really interesting. But in answer to your question, I think in thinking about what I understand of your question is, where am I suggesting people should be oriented, and where are people actually oriented? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, or if people were oriented towards different regions, then it seemed like what you're suggesting is people were oriented toward not here, that there's other places, and that you have an orientation that's very focused here, as in like Hartford, but also the home, but also there's a way that is there a way that being oriented elsewhere makes you more visible?
No.
Even though it's a local funding, so maybe it's a clarification of what's at stake with those with that kind of issue, the local, regional.
It's complex, obviously.
Yeah.
My experience, and from what I've witnessed and from what folks said in those conversations I had with them, is that orienting themselves to those geographies did not, in fact, make them more visible. It maybe allowed them to be part of certain conversations, but they were complicit in directing gaze away from here, which was them. But that what seemed to be possible but difficult was the idea that there could be many centers, right? That we could acknowledge the density of activity in certain places without making those be the only places we imagined cultural production could happen that was valuable. Is it possible for there to be many centers? Was a question that was raised a lot. And I think conversation, like one of the people I spoke to is Sarah Smith, Hampshire alum, and Amherst and magical person, talked a lot about having lived in a place like New York and making work there and feeling a different kind of scene, and now living in a place like this where her best work is being made, but far fewer people are seeing it. And that the conditions of her life, actually being able to live a life and not feel sort of the pressures that one feels in some other geographies, means better work, but acknowledging that it will be seen by far fewer people. Yeah, so there's this question of, one, this gaze outward is incentivized by the folks and the organizations that have resource. So that's a challenging thing, but is it possible, and from what direction is it possible to shift focus differently, to still be in relationship to other geographies, to not suddenly, for that to mean to be isolated or parochial, but to be in relationship to larger networks, but to also acknowledge and to see what's here in a different way, which I think is a difficult practice. And again, it's not incentivized, so it's hard to get energy behind that, yeah.
Wondering if any of that has shifted with the pandemic and putting so much work online, and I was so amazed at the very beginning with the proliferation of, you know, sources of watching dance and other art forms is pretty amazing.
It is pretty amazing, and you know, for me personally, I did a digital performance and I had people seeing my work from all over the world in a way that was difficult to do otherwise. But I've also been in conversations with presenters and venues who have zero interest in anything virtual from this point forward, which has many implications, not just in terms of visibility and direction of seeing, but also in terms of the kind of accessibility it allowed for lots of audiences that I think the hunger for people to get back into in-person performance makes them weary of continuing to offer that kind of program. I think some of us hoped that there would be some alongside-ness, I perceive some fear around that on the part of the presenters. Yeah.
Hi, Professor Lincoln. I'm Maria Catalina. I work at community advocacy, but I do that in
So I wonder, your research is fascinating, and I wonder, the question of citizenship for Koreans in Argentina, what is the status like? Is it similar to the U.S.? Is it a different sort of designation? I wonder if you could speak to that a little bit.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, it's really interesting because it's such a transient community. People go there, as I said, because they couldn't go to the United States or they didn't want to wait forever to go there. And then so Argentina sort of became a stepping point. And so, you know, I interviewed people where they say, you know, I don't even want to get to know them when there's new Korean arriving because I know they're going to leave, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a way in which, you know, it becomes such a, temporary station, right? But one thing that's so interesting too is, as Mrs. Oh was talking about, they never lost their Korean language, even as, you know, young immigrant who came to Argentina. And there's a way in which Koreans sort of look down upon Argentinians in ways like, you know, their culture is like mañana, they just can't stand it, right? It's like, what is this? And because their goal or aspiration is always to end up in the United States, they don't really care about the citizenship status. They really want to sort of accumulate as much wealth as possible, which is not to say that they don't contribute or, you know, that people don't stay permanently. During the economic crisis, there was all kinds of media articles about Koreans evading taxes, you know, exploiting Bolivian undocumented workers. But if you interview Bolivian workers, they say, I'd rather work for Koreans than Bolivians because they pay on time, you know? So there's these sort of incomplete stories being told about Koreans as a race, as people, as business owners. You know, they engage in practices that a lot of business people are engaged in. It's not just Koreans. It's not just, you know, they don't say, you know, Mrs. So-and-so did this, but it's always sort of lumped together as a race. If one person did it, then all the Koreans did it, right? So, yeah, I don't know if that answers your questions, but...
No. It gives some context.
Yeah.
I appreciate it. Thank you. And Susana Loza. Professor Loza, you're going to make me
want to
go back and watch all the
12.
Oh.
It just has such a different lens.
I never watched them, actually,
like,
so now I want to.
Yeah, no, I'm
fascinated by pop culture as a self-proclaimed social scientist. I look at a lot of reality TV shows. That's like my, relaxed time. and I always look at these issues of race in particular and, like, subjugating women and the interactions. And so, yeah, I just have a whole different consciousness around watching this stuff. So I really appreciate it. I mean, it's all my consciousness has always been there, but like, yeah.
It's what I pledge my life.
Right.
No, I appreciate it. Again, my consciousness has always been there, but yeah. Like to see it in a way that you like literally like dissect it was
amazing.
Thank you.
So thank you. Thank you.
Okay. All right, so I think this is our cue to end.
Oh, you have my hand. Okay.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you so much for your time. This is such a great opportunity to just hear about what faculty are doing, and I feel like students maybe don't know all of the labor that you guys are doing outside of classes, and so I just wanted to like extend my gratitude for that. And also, yeah, I was curious, both like individually and maybe like as the broader like Hampshire community, like in what ways do you see like supporting your own scholarship and like, you know, creating more bridges for collaboration, and also kind of just like for your individual projects, like what is the next step? Like where is this work being shared, or like what kind of is the futurity of this? Because I definitely am wanting to learn more, but also kind of just thinking in particular about our community here, like how can we better spotlight your work and as from a student perspective get more involved.
I think these kinds of events are really important. I was just going to say there's a total synergy between like my scholarship and my teaching, and there were several students that were here from settler mythologies who can speak to that, where they could see all those quotes that I made them read in different articles, and then they're seeing me put it into my scholarship, right? So that it is also about them seeing that, like, seeing themselves as a scholar, but seeing their professors as scholars, I think is really critical. Like, this is part of a larger book project I have called Settler Gothic that I hope to be on
sabbatical for? And I'm like, and I know that those are always really tough for students, for us to be gone, but that those are places in which, like, we come up with these ideas for our courses, and they really, like, give us the energy to be excellent advisors, because I don't think you can be an excellent advisor without being tapped into your own passion, like, as a scholar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Sierra, that's such a good question. I often want my own Div 3 committee. Like, I want...
Do it.
Yeah.
I've done it.
Yeah.
It's a good idea.
We should form our Div 3 committee.
Totally.
Yeah, Margaret Cirillo always talks about that.
Yeah. We need somebody to be our cheerleaders. We need somebody to be our accountability holder. I mean, just sharing this stage with Susana and Deb have been so wonderful. I'm like, why don't we do this all the time? You know? So, yeah, it's a larger conversation, but for sure we need more support for faculty scholarship at Hampshire.
I absolutely echo the Div 3 widely in the world. I think that there are a lot of innovations we have here in our education model that we don't translate to enough other contexts. I will say that Dasha Chapman, Layla Weidman, myself have had Div 3 meetings together over the last few years, and they have been transformational, actually. We don't do them as often as we'd like, but it's like, it's a good idea. We've had so many good times with students, and we're like, wait a minute. Mm-hmm. I'll see you at my house next Friday. So that's been useful. I will also agree that my collaboration with, like, I recognize you as a collaborator, Sierra, right? And others of you have been my collaborators in thinking about what home means, right? Like, those have been important spaces, and at the same time, there are really urgent moments when I have to leave you and actually translate it to the context that they're going to be in the world. And it's not actually enough to just do it during sabbatical, because one, it's not long enough, and often these things are much more prolonged than that timeline. And so it feels like a challenging thing to actually find that time alongside, mm-hmm. and not just the time, but the level of concentration that it requires. And I think for those of us who are also managing that in the context of a market, that it's difficult because these timelines don't align. Mm-hmm. And so it's a thing I'm managing. So right now I'm working on rebuilding an infrastructure that I had been building that has gone dormant, and that is necessary in order to make the thing happen more consistently. Because it's like, I can make the thing, but it'll be in my house again, right? And so there's a whole, hate the word business of the arts, that I have to rebuild. And then I have to figure out how can it be sustained when I'm back in the dailiness of mm-hmm. teaching, which I don't have the answer to that yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I tell my Div 3 seminar students, like, you need to write 30 minutes every day, like, no ifs and buts. And I try to walk that too, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's just the daily practice of building into your schedule, which is so hard to do because there are so many things that are pressing. Mm-hmm. But you can't let your work go, I guess, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.